Morning and a warm welcome to the seventh meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is a decision in taking business in private. Are members content to take agenda item 4 in private? Thank you. Our second agenda item is to begin to take evidence on a new inquiry which is focused on how devolution is changing post-EU and how devolution should evolve to respond to the challenges and opportunities of the new constitutional landscape. We are joined virtually this morning by Hugh Iranka-Davis, MS, Chair of the Legislation, Justice and Constitution Committee at the Senate, William Ragg, MP, Chair of the Public Administration and Constitutional Affairs Committee in the House of Commons, and Baroness Drake, CBE, Chair of the Constitution Committee in the House of Lords. We welcome you all this morning and a belated Happy St David's Day to our Welsh colleagues here today. Can I begin by opening a question and then we'll move to questions from the committee. But if I could ask, the view of the committee is that there are fundamental concerns which need to be addressed in relation to how devolution works outside of the EU. In particular, we've highlighted tensions between open trade and regulatory divergence within the UK internal market, and tensions with the devolution settlement, and tensions in the balance of power between executive and legislature in each of the four parliaments across the UK. I would like to gauge your views on what conventions and rules may need to evolve to meet these challenges, and particularly to ensure parliamentary scrutiny of decisions going forward. And if I could maybe invite Hugh Iranka-Davis to open, thanks.
Thank you very much, Chair. And it's a delight to be taking part in this inquiry along with other colleagues from other committees. I think we'd agree with your analysis that there is a tension, but it can be a positive tension. We're trying to work through some of the difficulties caused by the exit from the EU, and this does affect a range of issues in the devolution settlement. So the balance between the powers of devolved governments and the UK government, it's certainly we have issues to work for. I'm not going to call, they are concerns because we've reflected them in our various reports, but the effective operation of intergovernmental relations, the issues around legislative consent, how the issues of divergence work, how effective common frameworks are, and the impact of aspects such as the UK internal market on the operation of devolution post leaving the EU. The Retain the EU Law Bill at the moment, which is currently still progressing as we understand, causes us some great concerns, which I'm sure we'll return to. But it's not simply the unknown aspects of the scope of this and the detail of it, but it's also the speed at which it's being taken through as well. But we have other particular concerns in terms of Wales with the retained law bill as well. And also, I have to say, one of the things that we've observed just in a concluding comment to my opening remarks, is the overall lawmaking framework post-EU. We've seen increasing use of concurrent powers, Henry VIII powers, taking on of delegated powers to ministers, and in effect then, diminishing the role of scrutiny by the parliaments of the UK. And that is coinciding with the greater complexity of making law in the post-EU framework. So all of these are immense challenges. I'm not saying they're insurmountable, but it requires two things. It requires real goodwill between different partners within the UK governments and legislatures, but it also requires formal mechanisms to make it work as well. So it's a challenging environment at the moment.
Thank you. Could I invite Baroness Drake to...
Hi, good morning, everyone. Thanks very much for being invited. I think there were three elements, I think, to your question. One, the strains on the devolution arrangements between government and the devolved administrations and legislation, the scrutiny issue, and I think trade. taking the first one, I think the Constitution agrees, committee agrees with you that certainly post-Brexit, one has started to see more strains in that relationship. And we've certainly been tracking that and looking at that more. One of the issues that comes up is the use of secondary legislation more and more in areas of devolved competence or legislation. And we have said some quite strong, made some quite strong observations on that point, saying it is constitutionally dubious to begin to use secondary legislation more and more to intervene in devolved legislation or change devolved legislation or devolved settlements, and that actually there should be some tougher rules around that, that where secondary legislation is used, there should still be consent sought. And also, where secondary legislation has got Henry VIII powers, so it can actually change devolved legislation, that maybe there's a case for actually putting the requirement to consult or seek legislative consent in statutory form. So we've said quite a bit around that, and we are monitoring it. And actually, it's not only in the context of the relationships between Westminster and the devolved legislatures and governments. I think also we're seeing generally a problem of using secondary legislation more and more by governments and taking scrutiny away. I mean, I think we would see that as a UK problem as well. The other issue is scrutiny. As a general principle, it's good anyway, but because of the tensions we've seen post-Brexit, we have been asking, certainly at the Lords, for more scrutiny on this whole area of relationships and use of powers by the UK government and Parliament. And we have asked if, in terms of Lords procedures, there could be memorandums at the introduction of each bill into the House from the government detailing issues around the relationship or the need to consult consent and what's happening. And we've also asked, which has been agreed in principle but not operationalised, whether we can tag every stage of a bill as it goes through the House committee days as well, get an update on what's happening around seeking consent or any devolved issues. And the third area, trade. I mean, obviously, trade is a reserved matter, but we said because of the interests of all the nations in the trade issues, that actually there should be engagement and involvement in the negotiations and discussions on trade. But we do recognise it's a reserved matter.
Thank you. Could I invite Mr. Ragg, please?
Well, thank you very much indeed for your kind invitation. It's nice to see you again, albeit virtually, after my committee's visit to the Scottish Parliament early this year. And as you see, I'm wearing the Scottish parliamentary tie just to ingratiate myself with my audience. But having said that, I will maybe give a slightly different view to some of the things we've heard so far. And I also have to think to myself, when I hear the phrase devolution settlement, I always think, well, it isn't particularly settled to me. There is always an inherent tension. And I think a lot of the issues that we've already started to discuss this morning actually come pre our leaving the European Union. They've remained unaddressed largely since 1998. So I have to say that is really the absence of effective and meaningful intergovernmental relationships and indeed inter-parliamentary relationships. And in a wider UK context, with England representing 8% of UK population, the absence of England from that devolution framework is quite striking. In terms of legislatures and the balance of power between them and the executive, then, of course, as a confirmed backbencher in the House of Commons, I absolutely share that concern, the need for parliamentary scrutiny. I'm quite suspicious often of the increasing drive to use secondary legislation, introduction of framework bills, if I can term that, as primary legislation to allow ministers down the line to do X, Y, and Z. So I would share that concern. I think my overriding sense is that we're never going to take enough politics out of politics, but we can hold very divergent views on constitutional matters. I am a unionist. It doesn't surprise anybody to hear that, I would hope, but that doesn't mean it's not possible to have decent intergovernmental, interparliamentary relations. But I think a lot of the more celebrated differences might be able to be nipped in the bud much earlier on.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from committee members. I could invite first Dr. Allen.
Thank you very much. If I could first go to Mr. Aranka Davis. We as a committee have been looking at the impact of the changing understanding of the Sewell Convention, if I can put it as diplomatically as that, on our own situation in Scotland. And I know that this is something that the Welsh Government have commented on. But I wonder if you can say something about how the situation in Wales has developed from the Senedd's point of view, and particularly in light of the seven, I understand, instances where the UK has legislated without the Senedd's consent.
Yes, that's correct. We do have significant concerns in what has been referred to quite often by committee members of my own, but also by other Senedd members and even ministers, as the dysfunction now of the Sewell Convention. And I think this is a common theme, not just by us, but by other committees, including within the Lords and the Commons as well. We've seen a massive increase in the number of UK bills since the EU exit, including those that go greatly into devolved areas during the sixth tenure. So since 2016, UK Parliament has legislated massively within areas of devolved competence, but it's also legislated without the Senedd's consent in the area of seven bills, as you say, including legislation that implemented the UK's departure from the EU and post-Brexit arrangements matters as well. So Welsh Government recommends that Senedd withhold consent from all or part of five bills currently being considered. So there's another tranche of these coming down the line, including the retained EU law bill. Now, from our committee's perspective, our committee tends to run the rule across all of these bills coming down to Wales. We only express a view on consent in very rare circumstances. Normally, it's a very factual analysis. It highlights issues for the Senedd to consider. But we have occasionally expressed a view when we've seen it as of such significance. So, yes, we're seeing more of this, unfortunately. I take, by the way, William's point, fellow committee chair, that there will always be political differences, and there will be some bills where there's almost a choice being made to, if you like, lay down the law where the power lies. But if you look over the history of devolution, that's been a very rare challenge, and often it's resulted in challenges to the Supreme Court. Now we're seeing almost as a matter of fact consent being bypassed. That is a real worry.
If I can make a return on that point, again, trying to compare notes here, I mean, much of the debate here has been, or some of the debate in this committee has been about what the Sewell Convention actually means and what the words not normally might mean. In Wales, in the Senedd, is the Sewell Convention viewed still as being in the realm of real things?
I think there's a high degree of scepticism now within the Senedd and within Wales that the Sewell Convention is functioning properly. How can it be when the not normally now is becoming a regular matter of bypassing consent of the devolved legislatures? The not normal is now becoming almost normal.
Thank you.
I should have said to our panel today. If you do want to come in on any of the questions, if a question's been directed to someone else, if you could indicate in the chat function by putting an R in. I'm not sure what the R means. It might mean raise a hand. I don't know. But our clerks will be monitoring that. We'll bring you in as best as we can. So if I can move to questions from Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener, and welcome, panel. I've got a question for the entire panel, but perhaps start with Hugh, if that's okay. I'm interested in what role that you see for committees in your respective institutions in addressing some of the challenges and issues with regards to devolution in a post-EU environment, and what, if anything, could be done to strengthen the role of committees with regard to this?
My apologies, did you ask me to respond first?
Yes, that would be great, thank you.
Yeah, well, one of the interesting facets of the post-EU landscape, post-Brexit landscape, is from our perspective in Wales, it has ramped up into parliamentary engagement to a significant extent. It was already there before, partly because of the transition towards Brexit that had started to happen. My perception is, from chatting with my predecessor in this predecessor committee's role, is it's gone even further. So, and this is both on a bilateral basis of correspondence and engagement between committees and officials to flag up issues of joint concern between devolved parliaments, but also with UK parliamentary committees as well and chairs of committees there. But we also have a real belief that there is a need now to strengthen the mechanisms of interparliamentary work in a collective basis. We have the Interparliamentary Forum. I think there's great scope within that to develop more formal mechanisms beyond the coming together to discuss on a periodic basis broad issues of concern or opportunity, but actually to formalise the way we scrutinise. Because our view is that if intergovernmental mechanisms are being strengthened. We've yet to see them fully tested and fully bed in, but the mechanism has now been put in place for new intergovernmental machinery. We are pushing with success Welsh Government to be more transparent to us as committees and to the Senate as how they relay information on what is being discussed in those intergovernmental committees back to us. But we think there is a higher level, strategic level one, where the parliamentary committees should be able to come together, and the chairs should be able to come together at a UK basis, not least because of some of the issues that not only impact upon devolved competences and fall squarely within them, but also issues such as the role of parliaments in expressing the view from Wales or Scotland and Northern Ireland, recognising it's a retained function, but within trade agreements and so on. There's something here about being bringing together a much more formal structure at a UK level as well. So I'm genuinely excited about the potential of that, but I think we need to move now to match what's been done at an intergovernmental level.
Thanks for that. And just as a follow-up, Hugh, how might capacity for these increased functions affect your ability to fully scrutinise?
It's a very good question. We have expressed concerns as a committee over our capacity here in Wales, both within Welsh Government terms, but also in terms of parliamentary scrutiny here. We recognise, I can't evidence this in a quantitative way, but our clear perception has been, for one reason or another, our capacity here is stretched in Wales, and it certainly doesn't match as well, by the way, the capacity that is in Whitehall, either within government or within the parliamentary structures within Westminster itself. We have very good people, but we are small in quantum. developing the level of expertise and the levels of expertise as well, the quantum of expertise and the levels of expertise within our civil service in government, but also within our committee research and our ability to analyse the committees as well. So we do wonder about that, and I think that is something, again, to talk about, not just in a Welsh context. We can have that discussion and that argument and pushing for more resource, because we are worried that otherwise we'll be stretched too thin and things can be missed, particularly as we have things like the REUL bill coming forward, but generally with the number of LCMs we now deal with coming down with England and Wales legislation. But we also have maybe that discussion to have at a higher UK level to say, how do we make sure that across the UK we have sufficient capacity in government, and also, from my perspective, within the scrutiny functions as well. It is a concern of ours. We can see it being stretched.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I think if we move to William Ragg next and just ask for your reflections on the post-EU environment and how your committee is handling that.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Gold. And there's always an element of a busman's holiday out of these discussions, because we're key enthusiasts of discussing constitutional matters. Dare I say that is necessarily enthusiasm shared by all our colleagues, our respective legislatures, is it? So there's an element of that you take a horse to water, but you can't necessarily make it drink. And I found that particularly in the interrogations of the common frameworks. I think there's certainly a key role for the Interparliamentary Forum. I'm looking forward to, I suppose, playing host to that in a few weeks' time at Westminster. But as Hugh mentioned, an important aspect is transparency of the intergovernmental meeting. I mean, it was the case that, you know, my committee was able to give a little scrutiny, because we didn't even manage to get hold of the agendas before they happened. We had to poach them from the Welsh Government's website for us to be informed of what might be being discussed. Although that said, the surprising us with the communique at the end of the last one, welcome as it wasn't say a great deal, perhaps in the best tradition of communique. So I think there is a real real importance of individual members of our respective parliaments taking interest to show that there is that real appetite for scrutiny, because we go on demanding more and more scrutiny, but if we're doing it in a meaningful and targeted way, dare say it can be absolutely pointless.
Thanks for that. And we'll move on to Baroness Drake.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for that. Well, obviously, I'm conscious that the House of Lords is not an elected body. It has to recognise the primacy of the Commons. But I think where we can contribute in this whole area is through scrutiny we bring and the transparency we give to some of the issues and the tensions. And actually, more and more, the House of Lords is focused on that issue across its different committees. I'm obviously only speaking for the Constitution Committee, but we'll have the Common Frameworks Committee, we'll have the Trade Agreements Committee, who will pick up on these issues of the relationships between the nations. So I think that's where we can add value. And for example, in our recent report on the retained EU law bill, we have drawn out this whole issue of the common frameworks and not undermining the common frameworks because of the approach that the government wants to take on retained EU law. That's another example. And our Trade Agreements Committee has been pushing the government and seeking replies on a range of issues that would be of importance to the different nations as well. So I think the scrutiny, and we do more of that, and we're keen to raise these issues on the agenda. And I take William's point on intergovernment relations, because in the sense, you don't want to keep rushing to the courts to resolve issues. A, that's not my usual constitutional style, and B, it doesn't necessarily longer term lead to the best outcome. So how intergovernment relationships work in trying to mitigate some of this tension is quite important. And we share the concerns that William's expressed that, you know, what is in terms of the Parliament, what's the level of transparency that's being provided about how these intergovernment relations are working? Where's the opportunity to question and scrutinise? I mean, one area, for example, is how effective is the disputes resolution process within the intergovernment relationship working? So that is actually quite an important area that needs more transparency and more discussion, I think. And then, as we mentioned, we have the Interparliamentary Forum as well. So I think there are lots of opportunities. It's a question of how we leverage these efficiently to try and deal with some of the problems we know we're facing.
Thank you, Baroness Drake. Thank you, panel. Back to you, convener.
I think Mr. Ananka Davis wants to come back in.
Yes, it's a simple point to add to Baroness Drake's contribution there. Some of these things rub up against each other in a way that didn't have to happen. So our committee, and I suspect other committees, had set great store on the potential of the common frameworks procedures going forward. But let me give you one example here, and they do have great potential, and they started to come forward. There are issues around the slight variance in quality of some of the common frameworks we're seeing coming forward, which are being picked up by House of Lords Committee. But, for example, I mentioned the REUL, the Retained EU Law. So, when you look at dispute procedures with and how they work and how the common frameworks work, when you have a piece of accelerated law coming through for whatever reason, there's a real question then about the sheer extent of retained EU law covered by that bill, the ability then of governments to make full use of dispute avoidance, resolution processes, intergovernmental machinery, and all of that, and the common frameworks. So sometimes we're in a strange situation here in this post-Brexit immediacy of these few years, where some really good mechanisms have been put in place, but in some ways are being challenged to work effectively because other things are tramping across them.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell.
Thank you very much, convener. Good morning to you all. I wanted to start by asking you whether you think that the SEAL Convention should be more binding in its effect. And, you know, we've had evidence this committee that there might be a number of practical ways to achieve that. You know, my colleague's already mentioned about the word normally and its definition within the Scotland Act, for example. You know, there could be greater certainty over what conditions under which Westminster could override refusal of consent. There could be a body to consider a report on a justification for overriding, or a requirement for affirmative support in both House of Commons and the House of Lords. Those are some of the ideas that have been put to us. I'm wondering if this is something where you feel there needs to be greater attention and what your thoughts are on those types of reforms or any others that you're thinking about. Start with Mr. Ananka Davis, please.
Yes, very straightforward answer. We think the SEAL Convention as it currently is out of date because of the extent to which the not normal is now becoming normal, and there is a feeling of impotence in some ways when the SEAL Convention was always based to a large extent on the fact that not normal is genuinely not normal, but also on an understanding between governments and institutions on the way that it would work. When it becomes more routine, then devolved institutions, and particularly devolved parliaments, feel, what is this debate that we're having? Why are we sitting here saying we don't have consent, and we've produced the evidence of why there should not be consent for this? But it's just bypassed. So the scrutiny, in effect, is transparent, but ineffectual, totally ineffectual. So we would like to see something more more formal now put in place. Right. And I think the House of Lords committees have certainly put forward some interesting proposals in this. And there are also other interesting proposals being put forward by, for example, the, I can't remember the full name of it now, but the Brown Report, for want of another word, in a way that there would be some sort of, not only transparency, but some sort of challenge within the second house that could actually say, no, you can't just trample over consent. You have to take notice and pause significantly. Now, we like that because at the moment we feel slightly impotent.
Yeah. So just to be clear then, are you saying from the Welsh perspective it would be useful to codify that into legislation, into the presumably there's the Wales Act?
Yes, it could indeed be through the Wales Act or through some other measure that comes forward, but formalising it, codifying it, I think is the game in town now that we need to be in. This has gone beyond old-fashioned agreements and understandings and conventions because that isn't working.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I turn to Baroness Drake, please, for a Lord's perspective?
Pick up two issues, actually. Developing the point that Hugh has made about, the not normally. I mean, we have been saying, really, that it should be exceptional that that the government proceeds without consent, and they should make clear what are the circumstances and what has made it exceptional and why it has not been possible to get consent. But controlling that through accountability and scrutiny, we haven't proposed going beyond the constitutional settlement that exists, but actually accountability in the sense that can only speak for the Lords, but introducing disciplines whereby ministers have to report on what efforts, what is happening at each stage, the reasons why, and subjecting that to more scrutiny of having more formal procedural requirements, maybe looking at the Cabinet Office manual and other documents that underpin the way in which things operate to get greater discipline around this, what does not normally mean in practice, when can it be moved more to an exceptional situation. And the other area is the secondary legislation. We are concerned that there isn't a perceived undermining of the Sewell Convention by too readily resorting to secondary legislation, and maybe requirement to consult under the Sewell Convention where there's a Henry VIII power in secondary legislation is something that should be considered.
Mm-hmm. Would you see the advantage of any kind of structural changes within Westminster committees? Are the committees set up in a way that would allow that type of scrutiny to take place of any kind of overriding the Sewell Convention, or would there be a need for some innovation there?
Well, I think be careful what I say, because it's a bit personal view. I think probably the Lords is committee structure can, but obviously we don't have the extra demands that MPs have on their time. So I think our committee could do it. What we need is the procedures and processes for handling business in the House of Lords to make clear that on every bill at every stage we have visibility of this issue if there is an issue.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And then finally, if I could get a perspective from Mr. Rugg.
Well, thank you. Well, Speaker, demands on time. It's no demand by time to be here this morning. In fact, I'm missing out on the parliamentary away day, so I'm not sure if I'm grateful to the committee or not. But leaving that aside, I think, when you say not normally, you have to question, have we been living in normal political times? I would contend that we haven't. Whatever your view on the outcome of the referendum, it's been seismic, and its constitutional implications are seismic. So I think you have to look at it in that context. I also have to understand the context of the Sewell Convention and that undertaking given on the floor of the House of Lords during the passage of the Scotland Act, I think, in that what followed was a Labour administration in each of the constituent administrations, District Garden Island, of course, in the UK, whereby I suspect that the practical working relationships were on the whole better than they might be if you had administrators headed with different political parties. My personal view, I can't speak for my committee, but I favour a political resolution to this problem rather than a legal situation. Wiser heads than mine have suggested different means of that, a dispute resolution process. But all of those things do come down to, ultimately, if that dispute cannot be resolved, who resolves it? And I think that remains the unanswered question.
Yes, I suppose our institutions need to be resilient to whatever political circumstances that they find themselves in. I've just got one other question before I come back to the convener. I think it was Rodri Morgan who talked about the importance of devolution as a laboratory for policy innovation. I'd just be interested to get your perspectives on that. Do you feel the current state of affairs that we have in the UK is exerting a chilling effect on that policy innovation, given the ability of UK government to override particular policy innovations, or do you think things are in a healthy state? I'll maybe go back to Hugh Ranker Davis for this, I think, for a Welsh perspective.
I think it would be unfair to say that it's having a chilling effect, because I think devolved governments and legislatures have the confidence now, and we certainly in Wales, after 21, 22 years of devolutions devolution and five iterations of Government of Wales legislation, we have the confidence now to have, I think, the proper engagement between governments, but also to challenge where we think challenge is due. However, there is a big however on this. If you look at some of the pieces of legislation that we've recently been considering, so two particular ones, single-use plastics and on agriculture. It's not that there's a chilling effect, but there are real tensions here between what we believe are firmly within devolved competences and what could be now impacted by, for example, the UK Internal Market Act. So it's not a chilling effect, but it is testing. I think if it was a UK government minister here, they might say, yes, we think this goes right up to the edge, because we're taking a slightly different approach in Wales to single-use plastics. We'd probably be taking a different approach, as expressed in the agriculture bill coming forward, to England as well. And this does test I was talking about the complexity of post-EU law. It tests some of those things, including the how UKEMA works. Mm-hmm. So does it have a chilling effect? No, because the chilling effect would suggest that devolved governments and parliaments are more cautious about what they put forward. I think what it does mean is that we are going into ground that is new, and the complexity of post-EU legislation means that we are going to be banging up against each other more regularly until we see where the boundaries do lie and where the devolved governments and legislators can push the boundaries a little bit to establish where their competences fully lie. Single-use plastics is a great example.
Yeah, absolutely. I take from that we're in testing times, but there isn't a chilling effect there. Any perspectives from Mr. Ragg or Baroness Drake on this?
Well, I'm taken by the metaphor, but if you forgive the yes and ugly comment from me, you know, it depends what you put in the test tube, doesn't it? In any laboratory as to whether it's to date and everything else. And I think that what needs to be explored further would be, there can be difference, but is that difference reconcilable within the constitutional framework of the United Kingdom? that is ultimately the conundrum posed to us, and how we resolve that without the the laboratory, as Mr. Morton described it, bubbling over some.
Okay. Baroness Drake?
Yeah, it's just, again, developing on Hugh's thoughts there. I mean, the Lords or certainly the Constitution Committee, is sort of saying, that the devolution, it apply a positive attitude, provides an opportunity for policy experimentation and shared learning in terms of intergovernmental structures, as opposed to sort of command and control situation. And that if parties can come to the table with a kind of desire to, work on the problems, look what works best, what innovative or best practice could be brought to bear, and begin to experiment, begin to look at what would be better intergovernmental structures. I know that we haven't dwelt too much on intergovernment relations, but it is an area where the Constitution Committee thinks that if there was more transparency and discussion on that and sharing it more openly of the experiences, you may be able to come through with more innovative structures that help deal with some of the tensions that we've seen in the post-Brexit era, but also actually of itself use better practices and better progress. So yes, I think that's what I would add.
Thank you for those perspectives. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I've got a supplementary from Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Just for Mr. Ragg, you mentioned, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think you said that the recent things happening with Sewell were a response to unusual political times that we're living through. And I don't disagree with the fact that we're living through unusual political times. But I wonder, do you have any reaction to or comment on the fact that in this Parliament, one of the concerns we have is that the changes to Sewell are but one of the changes that are happening around us in terms of what many of us would see as a radically different view of the powers of the Scottish Parliament coming from the UK government. So, for instance, this is all happening in the context of the UK Internal Market Act. It's happening in the context of the Rule Bill, with implications on devolved law on an industrial scale. And it's happening in the context of, I think the first time UK ministers have intercepted a bill before it got to the royal desk since the days of Queen Anne. So I just wonder if you see that it's in part of a slightly bigger context than just Sewell, the concerns that get expressed.
Well, I think it's the impact of political tensions and, frankly, political differences. And therefore, whether seeing it through the prism of undertaken given on the House of Lords of 1998 is any longer a suitable way of viewing it. Do you think that the convention and the strain are completely redundant? And that, I think, is open to debate. And so I think in all of this, and the section 5, and it is, as I would say, constitutional, and it is a matter therefore for the Supreme Court on that particular issue that mentioned. I think largely, obviously, the political events that lead in the European Union, but nonetheless. I would contend that despite the difference of political view that there is, it is entirely constitutional.
Thank you.
Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Sorry, to the panel. Very nice to see some familiar faces. My question is again about Sewell, and to ask... I mean, it's the clear view of this committee that the Seoul Convention is under strain, I think are our words. But I think it's also important to reflect that there are still many instances of the Scottish Parliament agreeing to consent. There are also specifically incidents of the Scottish Parliament consenting to what might be called Brexit or post-Brexit legislation around fisheries and farming. And I suppose what I'm asking all of you is, to what extent is this about political differences? And also, particularly due to the political pressures of Brexit, or are we simply seeing tensions arise over something that has been incubated, essentially, since the start of devolution, but is only now sort of manifesting itself? And Hugh, if I could start with you, because I'm particularly interested in your experience of consent or not consenting, and where that's happening.
Your opening point there about political differences is a valid one, and from time to time, I recognise as a former UK minister, there will be reasons why governments choose to take a different ground, and that will be reflected then in the development of legislation and the way that it's taken through. I think we all have to accept that. Your ancillary point to that was whether there's something specific going on about the post-EU operation of government, and there is, because there are bills coming through that are coming through at pace and are coming through because of the post-Brexit agenda, and the government wants to do things that it has the entitlement to do, but it knocks up very hard then against not only devolved competences, but against the ability of us to scrutinise effectively what is coming through. Because when, from a Welsh perspective or from a devolved perspective, when we're doing this very often in legislation that's been done at a gallop, and that there hasn't been consultation between governments effectively, to come back to Baroness Drake's point, sometimes good intergovernmental working can actually resolve some of these issues before they happen. So when they're being done at the gallop and there hasn't been that involvement, then it similarly impairs the ability to do effective scrutiny as well. But the Sewell Convention, We talked about this already. I mean, I'd refer you to the piece of work that we presented in my predecessor committee to the Procedure Committee in the House of Commons. They're looking at this, and it considered then the aspects around Sewell, and I think it's probably got more, the tensions have exacerbated since then. But yes, one point I wanted to raise in particularly, though, was this aspect of it isn't simply the question of relationships between governments. We can't just rely on that. There has to be the formal procedures. But in this post-EU situation, we do have more complexity. From a Welsh perspective, we're doing things more at a distance. We're doing things through either UK Parliament-instigated legislation that are linked to the post-EU matters, or alternatively, an increase in propensity to do England and Wales legislation. And by the very fact of that, what we end up with then is less scrutiny here in Wales, and very often less time to do the scrutiny as well. So for a member of the public or a stakeholder in Wales, it isn't just for us as scrutineers, it's for them as well. They get less grip, less opportunity to input into it.
Could I turn to Baroness Drake, please?
Thank you. Yes, I mean, when the devolution settlement was made, it was in one political environment, and political environments evolve and change. That's not unique to the devolution settlement. I can think of other aspects of our constitution and conventions that have caused stress and strife over the last few years. And that's why, in fact, behaviours and cultures and transparency and scrutiny are so important generally moving things forward politically and constitutionally. But I think one of the big issues that's put stress, I think, on the devolution settlement was that when that settlement was first concluded, secondary legislation was largely to implement EU laws and directives. But once Brexit happened and there was going to be a huge repatriation of powers back from the EU, then you start to see the use of secondary legislation to do many more things than maybe were anticipated at the point of the devolution settlement. And, you know, we are in a different situation of not being in the EU and having to operate in that environment. I mean, some of the strains should ease, hopefully, as part of that repatriation is embedded and settled. Some of it will continue to be controversial. And I do think that's a major source of the stress because it cuts right across areas that people thought were settled. And leaving the EU, of course, has brought a whole new dynamic. But it does go back to, you know, the Constitution Committee are not proposing, not that they could anyway, a rewrite of the constitutional settlement around devolution, but they are saying that that change does bring with it a need to raise the bar on transparency, scrutiny, how intergovernmental working operates, and how the integrity around seeking consent operates.
Thank you for that. And finally, Mr. Ragg.
Thank you very much, Ms. Campbell. You've engaged from my answer so far. I probably agree with the premise of your question in that whilst there may be a number of structural issues, I do think quite a lot of what we have been discussing is to do with the nature of politics, the nature of having different mandates, perhaps within different parts of the United Kingdom, a debate over what are reserved matters, the necessity of legislation, given the repatriation of a whole raft of powers and areas of influence following our departure from the European Union, and all of that brings with it an inevitable tension. However, I think much of the rancour we then may have come through into more concrete dispute could be avoided on the basis of proper engagement, on the basis of the transparency to which Baroness Stake alluded to. And above all, to behaviours of ministers. I have to wonder if some of the dispute we've seen could have been voided. I'm speaking, of course, across the board here. I'm not just going to blame UK ministers, but I think that some of those issues that we've seen boil over may well have been more easily settled had there been since engagement earlier in processes.
Thank you for those answers. I mean, this is a similar question, I suppose, but it's more about intergovernmental relations. And obviously, there's been a new system of IGR, the three-tiered approach that was set up. I just wonder if anything can be learnt from the very recent agreement around the Northern Ireland Protocol in terms of sort of problem solving. I appreciate that's a very different situation. It involves the UK and the EU negotiating, albeit around Northern Ireland. And I just wonder if any of the panel have reflections on the negotiations, the personality, the ability of personalities to drive an agreement, and whether that is assisted by a mechanism around intergovernmental relations or not. And if I could start with Baroness Drake.
Yes, I mean, you know, it is in the nature of politics and the nature of moving forward that they will be heavily influenced by behaviours and cultures. And I think you've got to want and believe that you need to move on a consensus or consensual basis to solve what are fundamental issues for the country. I think if you don't have that in your armoury, then it gets difficult. So you do need that cultural context that says this is a problem for the UK, this is a problem for a nation within the UK, but that means it's still a UK problem because every nation matters. And we have to find an agreed way forward. And in a sense, that's very much a responsibility of Parliament as well. But it is something that I think is really important, that if you can create a culture of constructive desire to move forward on a consensual basis on things that seriously matter, that's really important. I mean, politics is politics, you know, and it's healthy politics and healthy democracy that people disagree. But I think there are moments in time, and you know, for the well-being for nations and the country, you have to try and proceed on a more constructive and consensual basis.
Could I turn to Hugh Aranka-Davis, please?
Yes, I would absolutely agree that when intergovernmental relations are working well, it leads to far better proposals for legislation, far better scrutiny. And we have seen good examples of this. You mentioned the Northern Ireland Protocol, that may indeed be one. But actually, even in the existing situation in Wales and UK, and bearing in mind we're trying to make the UK as a whole function very effectively and have that collaboration and cooperation. So when it does work well, it can work really well. And that has to be at an officials level, but also in the relationships between ministers. But it can't simply be on that understanding. It also has to be fully transparent. And that's the thing I think we need to drive at collectively, is increasingly transparent. What's being discussed? When is it being discussed? What are the outcomes of those discussions? And how then can we as scrutineers engage with it? So there are good examples of how this can work. When it goes wrong, however, it provides a couple of significant problems for us. When we have poor intergovernmental working, and we've seen examples of where it's been impaired, then once government isn't in a position to answer the questions that we put to it with sufficient timeliness and clarity and to the satisfaction of the Senate, and the additional issue is that when there isn't good, timely, effective intergovernmental relations, it's more likely, we've seen, to end up in provisions which will be of concern to Welsh Government and to the Senedd when we do get to scrutiny. So yes, the simple answer is good intergovernmental working really helps mitigate some of the problems that we're currently seeing. Question is, how do we make that common rather than, some are good and some are poor?
Thank you. I don't know if Mr. Ragg wants to add anything to that.
I just say my observations of recent negotiations regarding Northern Ireland are probably it's an outcome of hard work, respect and trust. And, consensus in politics is the most exciting thing quite often, but it is probably one of the most necessary. And I think that we live in an age of sort of big man or indeed big woman politics where everything seems to have to be entirely binary in arguments, and there has to be winners and there has to be losers. And I'm afraid in the context of devolution, that is not going to be a winning formula. So yes, I think there probably are lessons to be learned on the recent negotiations regarding Ireland.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Mintle.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel, for coming. Mr. Cameron trumped me there in his final question. I was going to be asking about any lessons that have been learnt from the recent engagements between the UK Parliament, Europe and in Northern Ireland. So I'd like to bring it back to one of the points that Mr. Anka Davies raised about how we can ensure we get the right scrutiny in a timely manner, because clearly all parliaments have got different timetables, and as Mr. Golden highlighted in his question, each parliament's got different resources. So I'm interested to hear about how we can ensure in the devolved parliaments that we are able to feed in properly in a reasonable manner, and we have the respect from the UK government about that. And I suppose one thing has just struck me as I've been listening to the panel's responses as well. And I'm wondering if there's something about the fact that the newer parliaments within the United Kingdom are pushing for change, but it's how do we get over perhaps a feeling that Westminster might be less willing for the change. I might be wrong in that perception, but I'd just be interested to know the panel's thoughts. So, Mr. Aranka Davies, if I can start with you.
I think that on some of the issues of transparency and better mechanism, we're not alone. We do have to push as committees, not just in devolved institutions, but also harnessing also the collaboration with House of Lords and House of Commons committees, who are pushing at also these issues of transparency, timeliness, good intergovernmental work. And we need to keep on pushing at that. And we need to see where the balance is between the informality of what the First Minister in Wales referred to in a different context as that regular, reliable rhythm of meetings and engagement at a ministerial level as well as official level. But we also need to really push that out into the public domain so our stakeholders as well as our committees and our legislatures can see it. But I think we also have a role to push at some of the trickier things we've been discussing this morning. So where UKEMA impacts upon devolved legislatures, even the Northern Ireland Protocol, funnily enough, because we're waiting to see how that works its way through now, the recent negotiations, but pushing so that we get full transparency about the devolves within aspects like that or trade agreements. The reason I raised the Northern Ireland issue at the moment is Welsh Government. We took an interest in this as a committee because of the impacts on, for example, Welsh ports and Holyheads and trade through Wales of it. And Welsh Government actually requested to attend a joint committee to discuss that. And we would have asked of them, tell us what you want to discuss, tell us what the outcomes were. But they would decline the opportunity to be on that joint committee discussing it. So I think what we need to do is to keep on pushing for greater transparency, greater accountability. And that is a service to government as well. But there's a will to do it, and I think we just need to work together as chairs and committees to make sure that the maximum amount of transparency is in the public domain. And the other thing I would say as well is, from a devolved context, we're just really concerned about the amount of England and Wales legislation and secondary legislation as well that's taking place. Sometimes, I have to say, I'm going to point the finger at Welsh Government as well, seemingly with the willingness of Welsh Government to do it. But what that means is it does bypass. We sometimes have a difficulty with government in explaining this to them. They say, yes, but we bring it back as an LCM. And we say, well, an LCM is not the same as a consultation with stakeholders in Wales or the ability to run it through committees here in Wales. So we have this in-principle point that it's better to do stuff that is significantly within devolved competences in the devolved legislatures.
Thank you for that. And yes, I would agree with your final statement there. And I think from our perspective as well, when we've been getting evidence from stakeholders within Scotland, they have said that it's an important way for them to get the Scottish perspective, and in your case, the Welsh perspective, through it, in. And also, I suppose that the next point is leading on to a transparency with the people of our respective nations as well, and making sure they understand what changes could be happening to them and how they get their say in doing that. Baroness Drake, is there anything you would like to add to that?
Yes, actually, I mean, led in fact by the Speaker of the Lords, there is a focus in the Lords on wanting the Lords' agenda to embrace devolution issues more and capture, understand and apply our scrutiny responsibilities to issues in each of the four nations. That's very much a sort of a thought process, certainly led by the Lord Speaker in what we're trying to do. And more the committees of the House are picking up or seeking to look at the implications for the different nations of agendas that fall on their table. Certainly the Constitution Committee does that. And therefore anything that improves engagement is important. I mean, we have the interparliamentary forum. I mean, obviously it starts gently, people feel their way, but hopefully that can build up into a more effective body. So I think that's really important, actually wanting that engagement, putting it high up, recognising we need to look from a Lord's point of view, certainly at the four nation perspective of things, which we are seeking to do more and more. I have to say, for my colleagues on the Common Frameworks Committee, they're quite ferocious. I'm quite impressed on their focus on this issue. And also how we approach scrutiny and transparency. We're not the Commons, but to the extent that we scrutinise, to the extent that we can, through what we do, increase transparency, that has to be a positive.
And if I may, Baroness Drake, you've touched on this in previous answers, but I just wonder if you can, again, just for the record, give your thoughts on how it might be made a bit more difficult for the UK government, maybe I haven't paraphrased that correctly, for the UK government to avoid seeking devolved consent.
Well, the issue that we have been airing is the use of secondary legislation to change issues or matters in areas of devolved competence, and particularly when that secondary legislation has Henry VIII powers, because strictly speaking, the Sewell Convention doesn't apply to secondary legislation. And what we're saying is the way in which now secondary legislation is applied, partly as a consequence of coming out of Brexit, but for other reasons, that there needs to be consideration of applying that convention in practice or in spirit or whatever to elements of secondary legislation, particularly where there's Henry VIII powers, and not just rest on, well, it's secondary legislation, we don't need to, because that really is not of constitutional good order.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Ragg, have you got anything to add?
It's just a reflection on, undoubtedly, the importance of devolved government in those nations in the United Kingdom that have it, and the understanding that comes with that. And whether that understanding is shared throughout the whole of the United Kingdom, i.e. England. And there is part of it wonders whether it is. That's not a malign thought. It's just a matter of fact and reality of everyday political life, such as it might permeate through to people. I think, though, there is something around UK ministers when they're wearing their UK hat and when they're acting with their English hat on, if I can, or their English Welsh hat on, if I can put it that way. An element of learning around that. And in terms of enthusiasm change, I might gently push back on that. Enthusiasm for change sounds like a very positive thing everybody can get behind, but it can also simply be a difference of political opinion. And I wouldn't want the two of them to be conflated in that way.
Okay, thank you.
Ms. Boyack.
Thank you very much. Can I just come back on that question to William Ragg there? I think that's really interesting in terms of what is kind of party political and what is kind of constitutional and the crossovers. And I think you mentioned the issue of respect and trust, and it's thinking about how do you embed that in the process. And thinking about your committee, to what extent would you be looking at legislative consent motions when there are devolved concerns expressed at a parliamentary level, rather than just an intergovernmental level? Just wondering to what extent that's on your kind of radar, and to what extent the MPs in your committee would challenge the government looking at an issue in the round. Thinking that retained EU law is like, it's very controversial on one level, but the stakeholder input we've had is on a different kind of scale for us in terms of people being unhappy. How would you handle something like that?
Well, it's certainly something that we consider, and I'd never want to give the impression that I'd recommit to you a rod line and dictate which way you go. And certainly look at the members of my committee, whether it's Ronnie Cowan or it's the likes of John McDonnell. You know, I have some quite keen interrogators of the policy. It's something that we would be open. I'd also, frankly, want to have a conversation with yourselves and with counterparts in devolved nations, because it's very well that I embark on, and my commission embarks upon, scrutiny. But there could be a risk that then at a committee level, you know, we'd be accused of what some accuse the UK government of interfering and overstepping our remit. So I think it would be something that would require quite significant, whether it's collaboration or at least consultation with committees such as the one which you said.
Yeah, and I'm thinking here about to what extent, when it's something that clearly is a devolved issue, you would actively consult with committees in the devolved legislatures to actually try and get that interparliamentary, not just the politics of it, but the interparliamentary awareness, so that committee members could see what the devolved tensions were and do it in a kind of formal way.
Well, I'm open to suggestions of how that might best work. I don't have the model in mind. A session such as this is an example of that engagement of, you know, effective chairs or committee members appearing before one of us committees, as we at PACAC have been grateful to have that opportunity as well. And later this month, with the inter-parliamentary forum, that is something that could be discussed at that. But I think it requires discussion and consultation rather than me simply suggesting a model of how we might do it.
Okay, that's very helpful. Maybe leave that with you and your committee to think about, because when you look at the report that our committee did, and then I was comparing it with the Syned's report, there's lots of crossovers, and there's quite a range of people in our committee. So I'd like to follow that question up with Hugh Ranka Davis. I was very interested in looking at the report your committee has done because of the crossovers in terms of our committee's thoughts. And I would like to get your comments on solutions, both on interparliamentary and on intergovernmental. So can I start off with interparliamentary relations? Because you've talked about your committee engaging directly with other counterpart committees. What are the key lessons there, do you think, in terms of how do we develop solutions in terms of respective devolution across the UK?
It's a really good question. I think this is really fertile ground in the post-EU landscape that we're now in. I mentioned in my opening remarks that one of the things this has led to is an increasing propensity for committees like ours, and yours I know as well, to liaise with other committees across the UK, see where there's common ground, but also in our various reports, to make those reports, to actively seek to make those reports available to other committees with interest in Westminster, including, where relevant, Baroness Drake's and William Rank's committee as well. But we also take the opportunity to write directly to ministers to make them aware as well, because I think it was a point picked up by one of the other colleagues giving evidence today, that sometimes there's a difference across Whitehall about how aware they are of the impact of various proposals, legislative proposals, on the devolved governments and legislatures. So we definitely have a role, and we're trying to step up to the mark within the resources that we have on every piece of work that we do, on every report that we do, to think where should we now be presenting this in order that it has the biggest leverage it possibly can. We don't have, in a sense, a formal mechanism to do that. And Baroness Drake's comments, as I've echoed as well, on the future of the Interparliamentary Forum and how that work can be strengthened is a good one on that high-level basis. But meanwhile, we're just trying to actively think on everything we do. Whose desk do we land it on so that they can actually use the powers that they have, the platforms that they have, to bring this to the attention of UK government
and UK Parliament? That's very helpful and very interesting in terms of our report so far. Can I ask you about the intergovernmental solutions that you've suggested in your report, and particularly the dispute resolution issue, the need for something formal there, and an independent secretariat as two potential solutions that would strengthen intergovernmental work? And can I just ask, was that something that was agreed cross-party in your committee?
Yes, it is. With credit to my committee, they genuinely are. It's a small committee. It reflects the size of the Senate as a whole. It's a four-person committee, but they genuinely park their politics outside the door. They listen to the evidence and they take a genuine approach, which says what is right for making the UK function as an entity, but also what is right for the accountability we try to deliver in the Senate. So those proposals, all signed off by the whole of the committee, we really do welcome the potential of the new intergovernmental machinery, including the moves to provide an independent secretariat, the dispute resolution procedure, but although we have yet to see the dispute resolution procedure being tested, and it's one of the challenges we've put to Welsh Government ministers is, well, we are having now not infrequent disputes that are presented in the public domain between UK Government and Welsh Government. Why aren't these being tested through the committee structures that have now been set up within the governmental machinery or through the disputes resolution? When will they be tested? Because we might have some significant ones coming forward. I mentioned the single-use plastics one. I don't know if that will be one, but there might be others. But we do think there needs to be something powerful behind the disputes resolution process. Ideally, in good intergovernmental working with the machinery that's now being put in place, yet to be fully tested, but it's there, you wouldn't want things to be escalated to disputes procedures. But it's there for a good reason, and that needs to be good and strong and binding. So our report makes clear our thoughts on that, and it's cross-party consensus on that.
Yeah, that's very useful. I kind of wanted that kind of clarified, because it's, given the tensions we've got, working out where people agree with each other is actually really significant in terms of recommendations going forward. Your other comment about transparency, do you want to say a bit more about how we would deliver that in the different legislatures, but also across UK to make that work? I'm conscious of the retained EU law makes it particularly challenging for all of us. But what would be your key recommendation as a committee?
Yeah, there are particularly challenges on the retained EU law, so I'll put that almost to one side at the moment. That's creating some real challenges on the transparency and accountability and legislative workload and competence, the whole gamut. So I'm going to put that to one side. In terms of generally the interministerial work and how we deal with that as parliamentarians and committees, we have had some breakthroughs with the Welsh Government. Welsh Government have been very good now at, by and large, at increasing the amount of information they provide to us in advance of meetings, what they're going to be discussing, what they put on the agenda, even to the extent, on one occasion, where we've actually grabbed the opportunity and made our own submission to government to say, well, you've seen our report on X, Y, and Z, we'd like you to raise these particular issues to do with legislative competence and so on and so forth. And fair play, that was discussed. But I think we need to keep on pushing, because I know that has not been shared by other committees universally, that level of transparency. I think the challenge would be, though, there's the one challenge for the devolved Senate committees and the parliamentary committees and the parliaments themselves in getting hold of this material about the agendas before and what's been discussed and what the outcomes are. There's the other aspect of how we do this at the high level, and that as yet isn't resolved. So how do the combined chairs, and Baroness Drake touched on this, some of the work that is going on, some, I understand, some discussions with the speakers' conventions and so on around this. How do we strengthen those high-level UK-wide fora so that we have the opportunity to test that jointly as to what you're being told in Scotland, what we're being told down here in Wales, what Williams Committee is being told and so on, and then to sit together and scrutinise ministers. Now, I don't know what the exact mechanism might be, but I suspect we need to go into that space now and see, do we have UK mechanisms for transparency as well?
That's really useful, and that's a really nice link to my last question, which is to Baroness Drake, to talk about that issue, about how you have that that scrutiny, and what you think the role of your committee is in terms of that, to ensure that the concerns that are expressed by devolved legislatures are actually taken on board when the House of Lords is doing scrutiny. Have you liked any thoughts on that, how to make the system work more effectively and transparently?
I mean, we are on record of putting forward a series of recommendations through different reports, which we're working through, saying we've achieved them all. I mean, in terms of the scrutiny, we basically said three things. One, in terms of the Lord, any bill that engages the Sewell Convention, and of course there's the question mark about, well, if it's secondary legislation, it strictly doesn't, but, you know, we would want it to do that in situations that of significance. That the government should submit a memorandum with that bill about, I'm just quickly reading what our recommendation says, about how the devolution implications and the engagement with the devolved administrations is going. So we get a memorandum which details what is the state of play on that issue when the bill is introduced into the House. And that might address some of the issues. Well, where is the point of disagreement? What are the tensions? The second one is what we've asked for, and it's agreed in principle, but it's not yet implemented, that our procedures in the House give granting or refusal of consent greater prominence in our business, so that if a bill comes forward at each stage, you know, second reading, each committee day, report stage, there's a tag to get an update on what's happening around consent issues. So what we're trying to do, if it's implemented, is embed having in front of us an awareness of these issues that are impacting the other nations. I mean, obviously not all bills would trigger that, but where it does. The other thing we have said in terms of maximising what could come out of intergovernmental frameworks, that going back to things like the devolution guidance notes, the cabinet manual, the guide to making legislation, that those sort of operational documents reflect what the intergovernment framework is trying to achieve. So there's a consistency. So it's not just one group of people sitting in a room. It actually flows through culturally to the other areas. And I think we would be interested in understanding more how the disputes resolution process is working. From what I understand, it's not been that tested yet. I'm not quite sure why, but that's another area. But those are the sort of things that we're pursuing.
And what kind of feedback have you had from the different governments on those issues in terms of to what extent are governments prepared to do the intergovernmental discussions, negotiations, transparency?
I put it down as discussions in progress, I think, really. We've had some response back, but obviously these things, you've moved them forward.
Yeah, I mean, the sense in our committee is that these are major challenges that have not really been experienced, and it's particularly post-Brexit, but it's in terms of the safeguards and going back to Sewell, the not normally principle, just to ask the extent to which there's an awareness of the significance of Sewell regularly being overridden, what the view is in your committee about that?
There certainly is in the House, because in a sense, the issue of using secondary legislation to determine policy and therefore, you know, taking away from Parliament that scrutiny is quite a big issue in the House of Lords at the moment. But it doesn't just apply to devolution. There's a general feel that that's an issue. And so we have been engaging with the government and asking for more discussion on that particular issue as a general theme, as well as its application to the devolved administrations. And what we also take the chance of every bill to reiterate points. So, for example, on the EU retained law bill, you know, we've spent some time talking about the implications for the common framework settlements. So we'll keep, you know, we try and stay with those themes and follow them through in each bill. And then we'll continue with engagement with the, I mean, the cabinet manual is an issue we're interested in generally. Evolution would be a part of that, but we have had quite a few exchanges and there should be a new draft of the cabinet manual, I think, coming out soon.
I think that would be something we'd be interested to see. But I'm very interested in that point you make about the retained EU law bill. Was there awareness of witnesses from different parts of the UK in terms of the work you were doing on that as a committee?
We don't take evidence on every bill we're dealing with, because in a sense, the flow of bills, and we have to get our view out quite quickly before committee stage. So, but we do take legal advice. We have legal advisors. So we would expect our legal advisers to pull out or highlight any implications for the nations as well as the UK, so that when we're looking at what we may comment in constitutional terms on a bill, that will be before us. It may be that there isn't any, or that there is, maybe you want to consider this. So we would try and mainstream it into our thinking when looking at a bill. We do that more and more.
That's very helpful. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm afraid we're tight for time this morning, so I think we're going to have to draw our session to an end. But can I thank you all for your attendance and say that the Deputy Convener and I are looking forward to our next meeting of the Interparliamentary Forum in the coming weeks. So thank you. And I'm going to suspend briefly to change over witnesses for a second panel. Thank you very much. Welcome back. We're moving to our third agenda item this morning, which is an evidence session on the proposed schedule changes to Radio Scotland's music programmes within the context of the impact of the BBC's Digital First agenda on broadcasting output in Scotland. And we're joined this morning by Steve Carson, Director of the BBC Scotland, and Louise Thornton, Head of Commissioning for BBC Scotland. I can invite Mr Carson to make an opening statement.
Thank you and good morning, Convener and members of the committee. Thank you for the invitation to speak to this committee of the Scottish Parliament this morning. I'm pleased to be here alongside Louise Thornton, as you say, Head of Commissioning for BBC Scotland. If we can give you just a brief overview of our music strategy to bring you up to date before inviting questions. The context on our music strategy is that on-demand or so-called digital listening to music has tripled in the last 5 years, while live radio listening as across the board has decreased over the same time period. So more and more people are listening to on-demand audio, and the podcast market is seeing significant growth. In fact, according to Ofcom research last year, music streaming in Scotland has now become as popular as listening to live radio on a radio set. Now, this is across the industry. Of course, our live radio services are crucial to us and will remain crucial. But audience patterns are changing, and the BBC, we need to change with them to stay relevant. The good news is that audiences are coming to us on new services like BBC Sounds, as well as on Radio Scotland. Last quarter, there were more than 4.7 million plays of BBC Scotland originated content on Sounds, and BBC Radio Scotland remains the second most listened to station in this nation. So keeping in line with audience behaviour requires change. The financial context is that we can't move to where our audiences are moving and at the same time do all that we currently do in exactly the same way. We recognise the privileged position we're in with the licence fee, but since 2010, the BBC's income in real terms has fallen by 30%. And of course, like every business in Scotland and every creative and cultural institution, we're facing limitations on our income against a background of high inflation. But I also want to make it clear that although the financial background is there and challenging, there is real ambition behind this strategy. We are passionate about showcasing Scotland's music and finding, backing, promoting Scottish talent to audiences here and around the world. And we actually now have a range of services from Sounds, iPlayer, the Scotland Channel, BBC Alba, alongside our traditional live radio services with which to do that. So the headlines around our strategy have focused on us making changes to the team that makes our piping programme, changes to the format of classical music on Radio Scotland, alongside the decision to decommission Jazz Nights. That is part of the story, but within the context I've just outlined, the story also includes some of the following factors which I'd like to brief the committee on. There will still be a classical music programme on Radio Scotland every week. We invest £5 million of licensed fee payers' money in our BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra every year. We're proud to do so. It is a world-class orchestra. Going forward, we'll hear many more of their concerts on Radio Scotland. We're also looking at working with other orchestras in Scotland to share their music more widely on our new classics programme on Sunday evenings, which will now be focused entirely on Scottish orchestras. We're launching two new national competitions, one for classical and one for jazz musicians, along the lines of the extremely successful BBC Radio Scotland Young Traditional Musician of the Year. So our strategy is ambitious about our role in developing new talent in Scotland, something that Louise, our Head of Commissioning, is particularly passionate about. And we will now have four targeted development programmes for Scottish musical talent alone. And that's in addition to all the other work we do in other genres to find and support Scottish talent. We're expanding the remit of the afternoon show to include interviews about the jazz sector, and jazz music will be part of the mix of live music on the key sessions. And I would point out as well that the afternoon show itself is exceptional across the BBC in putting arts and culture content every weekday on peak time daytime radio. And in addition to the radio offer, we're launching a new culture podcast. We're securing a commission to make a new series of on jazz for BBC Radio 2. And we will have a piping programme in the current slot on Radio Scotland that would be made in collaboration with our Gaelic service, Radio Nangeal. We're also commissioning a new piping podcast, which will take Scotland's music to a wider and potentially global audience. So we, of course, understand the passion, the loyalty people feel towards programmes they value and love. But we believe we can creatively deliver for classical, jazz and piping audiences in new ways, which will help our content and Scottish talent reach as wide an audience as possible. So Louise and I look forward to discussing this in more detail with the committee this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you'll have heard our session and have seen the session that we had last week with some of the artists and institutions involved in raising their concerns about the changes. Mm-hmm. So the question I asked them was about, you know, when I guess the last big discussion we had about this was around about the charter renewal. And at that time, I think Fiona Hislop had made clear that it was really important that creative talent was supported in Scotland and that the unique culture of Scotland was reflected and was expecting the BBC to support that. So given, if you just think about the status of our Royal Conservatoire now in terms of international recognition of that and the fact that jazz is a big part of that and recognise how successful the Young Traditional Musician programme is. And I'm glad to hear that, you know, that's been replicated across to other areas. But do you feel that you're meeting the charter objectives of that uniquely Scottish provision for a Scottish audience in what's happening going forward?
Yes, we absolutely do. We remain absolutely committed to broadcasting the best of Scottish culture and looking at the budgets that we have and making sure we really add value. We are part of the wider BBC portfolio, but in Scotland it's so important that we offer distinctive output that really celebrates the talent that we have, and also working in partnership with organisations like the Conservatoire, where we have a really healthy dialogue. These changes, and we understand the passion and we understand change is difficult. These decisions aren't easy, but we have to go where the audience is and we have to reflect the changes in consumption, and we have to have the budget to be able to spend in an efficient way. So we've looked across, these are part of a wider raft of changes, and we've looked at each of these programmes and genres and thought really hard about how we can continue to offer distinctive content and a uniquely Scottish offer. In terms of jazz, we're really excited about this competition. You know, I think for BBC Scotland to have that relationship with new talent coming through, and for BBC Scotland to really own that as a competition throughout its services. Radio Scotland will be the home of that competition, but in the way that we've seen with Young Trad, it will come through all our platforms and services, and that talent will be able to be exposed in lots of different ways. We also feel really excited about the direction of travel with the afternoon show and launching a new culture podcast for Scotland. We should be doing these things. You know, the easiest thing in commissioning is to do nothing, really. You know, we could sit here and do the same programmes as we always have done, but we must look at the data and we must look at how audiences are changing and what audiences expect of us. So moving into the podcast space, BBC Sounds, where we see growth. We have our own rail on Sounds now for Scotland. Being able to offer a podcast that really celebrates culture in Scotland, where we will hear these stories of talented musicians from jazz and all the other genres, but be able to really hear those performances come through as well. And I think the third part of that really is what we're doing with our live output. Key Sessions is a really good brand for us, and it's getting audience recognition. So we feel that this is a great place for us to start bringing through some more live performance from jazz musicians, where we can get more exposure and, you know, really kind of like use our platforms in the best way and the budget that we have.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Carson, do you want to comment? Or?
No, I think just to echo what Louise has said. I mean, it's, you know, we're confident we go well beyond our charter obligations, but I would stress that we do this out of passion because we want to do it, and not purely from a regulatory point of view. And I do think, you know, overall what we're trying to do here is use the range of services that we now have that we know audiences want, and kind of use the whole portfolio within Scotland to basically make our content more widely available to more people. So again, if you look at, you know, putting some musical genres in the afternoon show, that's a really big audience proposition. The afternoon show, we're very proud to have it. There's more chance of audiences finding jazz and other music on that show. And at the moment, I think the nature of broadcasting is if there's a specific show to cover that genre, other shows then tend to back away from that. And what we're trying to do is integrate this much more across our portfolio.
Right, just to pick up on something you said, Ms. Thornton, you said we've got to go where the audience goes. Is it the audience numbers that are the main driver to the decision making?
It's not just audience data. It's trends. It's qualitative response from, you know, audience saying that they expect Radio Scotland to be a modern service that linear is very strong, but actually how are we moving across platforms? But it is also, as Steve says, we have a challenging financial backdrop and we need to be spending efficiently. So yes, we do look at audience data, we look at verbatims, but we also, as general part of commissioning practice, we look at how we're spending money and we always think, are we getting the best value for the licence fee?
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee and go to Mr. Ruskell first, please.
Thank you. I heard recently that a German national radio station has commissioned a series of programmes about the Scottish jazz scene. They're showcasing Scottish jazz talent. They're very excited about it. Do you not think it's pretty shameful that our own national radio broadcaster is not creating that space for Scottish talent, but the German national radio broadcaster is?
I would say that with these changes, we are trying to give jazz more prominence because we're moving those stories into our fantastic afternoon show. And as I said before, we are really excited about this cultural podcast for Scotland, and that is exactly where those stories and that celebration of talent will be able to happen.
But Jazz Nights has 60% of the artists that are on Jazz Nights, 60% of the track listings are from Scottish artists, they're from emerging artists. There's no way you can get that kind of coverage in the afternoon show. There's no way you can get that kind of coverage within the formats of linear programmes on Radio 2 or Radio 3 that then end up on BBC Sounds. It simply can't be done. So you are constraining that genre, you are constraining the creativity and the talent of that genre into tiny little slots within mainstream programmes, are you not?
It's a fair point. We won't have the volume that we used to have in terms of a show that you know, played out in a certain part of the schedule.
So you acknowledge then that this has been a damage, Jazz?
This is about getting more exposure in terms of and investing in bigger brands as a strategy, and also looking at audience behaviours. You know, we've got a fantastic digital team in Scotland who would be also creating content to support the podcast and in key sessions and in terms of what the afternoon show is doing and the competition itself. So we're trying to lean into bigger moments and bigger brands and use our money more effectively to get more exposure.
Yeah, if you want to
reinforce that's possible, Mr. Ruskell. So there's a twofold strategy here. Obviously, we're talking exactly as you say. There's a vibrant Scottish jazz scene. We're having to take a question: how do we best serve that? How do we best reflect that? There is one option, which is to stay as we are and have a specialist programme every week. But again, on linear radio, despite Radio Scotland being incredibly popular, incredibly diverse, it's likely to decline in audience listing. Are we then just allowing for that market, that audience, to decline for Scottish jazz? So if we do things, as Louise is proposing, to put jazz music at the heart of bigger things, but again, bear in mind, we're having a new talent competition for jazz musicians, really focusing hard on what we can do in Scotland, as you say, that other BBC stations won't be able to do. What we can do is help nurture, identify and find Scottish jazz talent, and that's exactly the initiative that Louise is behind.
Your linear programme, Jazz Nights, which is a long-standing slot, it's been there for years, influenced Tommy Smith and many others. Yes. That is on BBC Sounds, so it is available. I would imagine you could do more to actually promote that. But let's just imagine that you're an aspiring young jazz musician. You've spent hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours, thousands of hours, improving your skills, and you know you're about to make that breakthrough. You could enter the competition, that you intend to set up. You could get some exposure through that. But where do you go then? Because if there isn't anywhere to then go on and play your music, if you're restricted to one tiny slot within the afternoon show, there's no specialist Scottish jazz programme anymore on the BBC. Your ability to get onto programmes on BBC Radio 2 and Radio 3 are highly constrained. Where do you take that? You're sort of, so I can see at one point you're nurturing talent up to a certain level, and then you're cutting away the platform where they can get exposure, where they can then get profile, and they can go on to develop their careers. Where's the progression? If you're a young Scottish jazz artist, where's the progression?
Part of our strategy about having a relationship with talent is also about how we can get them into different parts of the schedule as well. We've just had a really successful Hogmanay programme where we've celebrated lots of different artists. We have moments in the cultural calendar, like Burns, for example, where we would like to do more. And we feel that having these moments where we can bring through musical talent that we have a relationship with, then we can do more in our schedule and our platforms in that way.
So will that be more airtime for young Scottish emerging talent in that jazz scene as a result of you cutting jazz nights, or will it be less, more or less?
It's new ways of doing the same thing. So as you say,
is it more or less?
You're quite right to point out with a talent competition, but it's a potentially very significant thing that young trad is an enormous moment in the schedules across the services. But you're right, we then go beyond that. So jazz musicians can feature in the key sessions. Traditionally, they have not. The new strategy is that they will. So there's various stepping stones there through the services. And of course, then we are linked into the wider BBC portfolio. We think our job is to help nurture not just young talent, but new and emerging talent, established talent, and provide pathways within our services and then onto other BBC services. So
just,
as I mentioned, we're making a jazz series.
Come back
to
my fundamental question. Will there be more or less airtime for Scottish jazz talent as a result of you cutting jazz nights and the reforms that you proposed?
I think by volume, less airtime on Scottish jazz, but I think reaching
less
potentially
airtime.
Bigger audiences, yes.
Right, thank you. Less airtime for Scottish jazz as a result of that. Can I just finally ask about what expertise you have in terms of commissioning across the three genres that you're proposing to make changes and cuts to? So what kind of musical expertise do you have in these areas as commissioners?
We're broadcasters. We have a range of backgrounds and experiences within the team. We're held to the highest editorial standards. We work across a portfolio of genres, and we have amazing skills and experience within the suppliers and the talent that we work with. We fully engage in creative conversations as part of our daily conversation, but we're here for the audience ultimately, and that is a skill that we bring. We look across a broad portfolio, and we adhere to editorial excellence.
Right, but you don't have specific skills in these musical genres. So I suppose my question is, do you understand these musical genres and how important they are, and the educational aspect in terms of for the listening public as well, the importance of having a curated show that takes the listener through a journey in understanding that musical genre?
We aren't professors of music, nor would we purport to be, because
I don't want you to be a professor, but just say, do you have expertise in terms of commissioning?
Yes, but we're absolutely passionate about arts and music and culture in Scotland, and that's what we're here for.
Okay.
Yeah, and again, across the entire range of our output, as we say, Scottish music in all genres, Scottish arts and culture, they're heavily featured throughout our entire output. It is a key part of what we do, and we have expertise in commissioning that, yes.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Ms. Mintle?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel, for coming along today. I appreciate that we're all working in very difficult financial straits, and my previous role in the BBC was involved in that side of things as well. But I'm interested to ask about specifically about the archive and what we could be losing by not having live performances. And so I know when you're making radio programmes that the archive plays a large part in what you've got, and we need to keep increasing that. And you are custodians of a vast archive of Scottish cultural music, etc.
We are, and we have a huge production archive. obviously there are different rights issues in terms of what we can allow access to. I mean, we don't always hold rights in perpetuity for everything. I think what we're really trying to do with this strategy is to make sure we still have live performance coming through the schedule, so we're still adding to that archive. We're broadening out, as I said, what Key Sessions does. We're creating a cultural podcast that will have performance and those elements within. And I think where we really, you know, add value within the piping community, and we know that was a concern, we feel launching this new podcast really addresses that point. As I said, we know it was a huge concern about where that piping archive lives. And the podcast will give us that opportunity to have those original recordings in a prominent place on BBC Sounds that can also reach an audience wider than Scotland and the UK, because we know there's an international market as well.
Yeah, I think you'll have watched the evidence last week. We got evidence from the musicians that these programmes were already reaching an international audience. And I think there was a concern, kind of reflecting on some of the questions that Mr. Ruskell asked, that could be lost. I think it's also a question about how that archive is grown, because all the musicians that came last week talked about the pleasure, the positive memories they had recording for BBC Scotland. And my colleague Sarah Boyack and I were at a very interesting cross-party group on culture in the community. And this was one of the things that the panel last week commented on, the fact, the impact on community music and how you're going to continue to grow that. And there was a quote that really struck me on Tuesday night's meeting, and it was the privilege of imagination and play. And I've been thinking about that, and I think the BBC Scotland is in a very privileged position to enable that imagination and play to happen across Scotland, across Scottish communities and culture. And I'm very concerned that the solutions that you've put forward, specifically in the jazz, might not allow that imagination and play to continue in that musical genre. But also from the piping perspective, Finlay MacDonald gave us a really important view behind how different communities in Scotland view piping and the different stories behind that. So I'm concerned that might be lost. So I'm interested in how you're going to mitigate, compensate for these concerns that were raised specifically by the musicians last week.
I guess, first of all, we have an amazing outreach programme with our Scottish Symphony Orchestra, and we do amazing work with communities all year round. So that will continue, that won't change. And as we said, we're bringing the SSO much more into Radio Scotland to get a much more, you know, coherent offer for the audience. In terms of the piping community, we will still have a piping programme on Radio Scotland in the same slot. So that won't change. The way we do the programme is changing because we need to spend money more efficiently and reflect audience changes and invest in digital. But We get a great audience round about the World Pipe Band Championships, and it really is brilliant, and it's a multi-platform offer. And I want to be able to invest and grow those moments where we can really celebrate piping, something uniquely Scottish that we can take to the rest of the world. So launching, having that podcast moment on Sounds prominently as a marketing opportunity, that's where we see those moments that we can really engage audiences and bring through those community stories that you reference, and bring through these live performances that has been mentioned in terms of a living archive. So we really do feel passionately about this, that we are considering these points and thinking about the best and most audience-focused way of making sure we still deliver on those aspects.
Okay. You've talked a couple of times about the podcasts and using live recordings for that. You also mentioned briefly the issue around rights. And if I understand it, there could be some issues around rights with regards to new music and how long you can actually play that on podcasts. So therefore, I suppose my question is, Is that going to then impact on the ability for you to grow the archive with new musicians playing across Scotland in different venues?
That's a consideration for every programme, as you know, and that's an ongoing conversation at the moment about how we do that.
Discussions about the amount of time of music that you can play, because I think is it 30-second inserts that you're allowed to put into podcasts, or is it bigger, or how are these discussions going?
Rights is a complicated business, as I'm sure you know. It depends on the nature of the performance, lots of different things, you know, in terms of writing talent. But you know, we have lots of music podcasts on BBC Sounds where we are able to play differently. Do you want to come and say?
Classically, rights restrictions such as you're citing there are for non-UK audience globally. Sometimes you can secure and sometimes you can't. But for UK audiences funded by the licence fee, it's a different position generally.
So there is a question there about where the audience is coming from, especially if your plan is to grow international audiences, then if you've got this contrast of 30 seconds, which is international, and what you can listen to locally, I'm feeling there's a bit of a challenge there.
I mean, first and foremost, we're here for the UK licence fee payer, so we want to get it right for our audience, and you know, in this situation in particular, our audience in Scotland, to make sure you know we're giving value to them. But yes, rights is a consideration in terms of how we go more internationally.
And then the BBC SSO mainly commissioned, or its output is commissioned by Radio 3. I know that the funding comes from BBC Scotland's budget. So are you working with Radio 3 to commission a different type of output? How's that relationship going to work?
What we're trying to do with the SSO is, we had a situation where they didn't really appear very frequently on Radio Scotland, and we spend, you know, over £5 million on the orchestra, and they're fantastic. So this is about taking fantastic recorded concerts that they're playing, you know, weekly, and building a programme for Radio Scotland to make sure we still have classical music on our airwaves in the same slot. And that's the way we will work. And yeah, we will absolutely work collaboratively with Radio 3 on that.
Yeah, I think that even from a live radio point of view, that's an advantage, is that we're now going to have concerts every week. The Scottish Symphony Orchestra will feature very prominently in that, in a way that we haven't been able to do before. And our new classics offer in Radio Scotland will be very focused, will be entirely focused on Scottish orchestras.
Okay, and if I may, just my final question. Sorry, my apologies.
We are running out of time, I'll stop, sorry. Yeah. Usual Thursday morning challenges. Thanks. Are you sure?
Yep.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Boyack?
Thanks very much. It was really useful to get your update that you sent us on the 16th of January, and it kicks off by talking about the BBC's income declining in real terms by 30%. Before the 22 licence fee. So get the pressures on you, and we've had that described by the head of Creative Scotland as a perfect storm for arts and the culture. And the other key quote from Tuesday night's cross-party group was, you can't eat art. So it's that thing about careers for artists, and it's to slot in where that fits with BBC Scotland. And it's to try and explain it to us, because in terms of the BBC Charter, I think four of the five key charter principles, this is the live music in terms of pipe music, jazz and classical, totally fits with that. Explain it to us. You've got live performances. That was an issue that was mentioned as a massive loss last week by performers. Then you've talked about podcasts. You've talked about the reduced use of live radio. Isn't there a way that you can actually use live broadcasts, put them on podcasts, put them on live radio, and put them on BBC Sounds? Where's the cut across in terms of the finance? Doesn't it make sense to reuse that content at all points and explain to us about the cutting of the programming in terms of the finance of this?
This is an opportunity which we welcome to explain that you know, those musical genres and wider arts and culture in Scotland remain at the heart of our schedules and our offer. You know, we have, I think, explained why we need to do some things in slightly different ways. I think there's three contexts there, some of them quite positive. So one negative one is financial context. To do something new, we have to make some difficult decisions about what we currently do in some places. And this is part of a wider piece of work we're doing about changing how we spend our content budget. The second context is audiences are changing. If we remain as we are, we will be not providing services, including jazz, piping and classical music, to how audiences are consuming increasingly and want to consume our services. And then the third one, which is a positive, is that since some of our weekly radio programmes were set up some decades ago, we now have a whole range of other services by which we can engage and reach Scottish audiences. As I mentioned to you, BBC Scotland Channel, BBC Alba, BBC iPlayer, BBC Sound. So it is exactly as you say, Ms. Boyack, about how we then make sure that the same content, and we remain committed to live recording and our role in supporting practitioners, as well as obviously focused on the audiences for those programmes. We are using all those services together. Louise's role within BBC Scotland is to have all the services from radio, TV, online and social together to get that integration. But you know, difficult as these changes are, we think overall the audiences will benefit, and they'll find content, including jazz content, and a more wider range of services, more with larger audience potential. But absolutely, music, arts, culture, our role in helping to support and develop the Scottish creative industry is absolutely central to what we do.
So where's the disconnect then? Because we got really strong representations last week in person in this committee, but it was also backed up by a huge number of people writing in and the campaigns being run. People are very worried about that loss of access to live performances. So where's the disconnect?
I think it's obvious when people hear this is cut, that is cut, this is cut, they think, well, there is no more classical music, piping or jazz music on Scottish services or wider BBC services. And so I hope we've been able to explain that that's not the case. Live performance, live music is central to what we do and continues to be. We are talking about reaching audiences in ways where they increasingly want to engage our services.
And part of that strategy is about leaning into bigger brands as well, and not spreading yourself too thin, really leaning into parts of the schedule across the platforms, not just within radio, but where we are getting a bigger, broader audience and where we can get more exposure. But we understand the passion, we understand the specialist music lens, you know, that your representees you bring, and we hope you understand that, you know, the passion for arts and culture and the volume that we continue to deliver through BBC Scotland still remains.
Bring in Dr. Allen, Mr. Cameron.
Tommy Smith, the distinguished jazz musician, was pointing out that a number of European countries, some of them similarly sized, have a whole channel that will do, a whole radio channel that will do jazz, a whole radio channel that will do traditional music, a whole radio channel, public service broadcasters, I mean, that will do classical music. Why are we still in Scotland arguing about a couple of hours here and there?
Reconnecting across a broad range of genres, and we're looking at the reality of our financial position. Director General set at the strategy for value for all, which means we're pivoting to digital, we're investing in high impact content, and this is part of the strategy that we're enacting in Scotland, and we are trying to make these decisions in the smartest, most effective way possible. They're part of a raft of changes, but we do have really successful arts and culture output on Radio Scotland. You know, we've got a really brilliant show in the middle of our schedule. I feel it's right that genres like jazz and stories from you know, talent across Scotland should be celebrated more in that programme. And we are launching a culture podcast, which is, you know, hopefully going to be brilliant and really successful, and we'll all listen to it and discover new forms of music and talent that we hadn't previously heard about. So that we are looking at the reality of our financial position and just trying to make the smartest decisions for the audience in Scotland.
And I think, Dr. Allen, I mean, I've experienced working within the European Broadcasting Union, and you're right, there are different approaches to public service broadcasting, and some European countries look at an approach of having a whole number of services aimed very specifically at things, and some, you know, the BBC approach and other broadcasters that we'd be familiar with is often like, well, let's, you know, have that content, but put it in a bigger, more all-encompassing service. I think the evidence is that then can help those practitioners and that content break out of a niche. And I think that really is the overarching strategy that we're pursuing here. So you know, a weekly programme can do a lot. Okay. We think sort of integrating a whole range of things into sort of bigger, what we call brands, but bigger shows, bigger services is a way to kind of serve audiences better.
Okay, and my other questions, I'll roll into two questions really, but first one is you'll have to translate for me what leaning into bigger brands means. I just don't know what that means. Who are the bigger brands in piping? And does leaning into bigger brands mean leaning out of diversity? What does that mean? The second question I had was again on the back of yesterday's, last week rather's, evidence. Was it both from the piping point of view, Finlay MacDonald, and from the jazz point of view, Tommy Smith, were asking, does the new model that you're describing for Radio Scotland involve more of a DJ model for programmes? In other words, does it involve fewer live performances and less engagement with experts?
So first of all, apologies for BBC jargon. Leaning into bigger brands to me means looking at where we have, you know, significant impact with the audience. So we've got a bigger audience in the afternoon show. It should be doing more for us. The key sessions is an established programme brand, programme title. I'd like to do more with that to support the genres. To come to your question about DJs, so with piping on Radio Scotland, we had two teams making two separate programmes, so we will have one team making one programme. But what we've taken on board is, you know, we want to keep the live performance aspect of piping. We know how important that is. And that's where our podcast, which will give us a bigger moment of celebration round about key moments in the calendar, like the World Championships, that's where that will continue to happen.
Thank you.
Mr. Cameron.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask you about pipeline specifically? Given the particular connection it has to the Highlands and Islands, which I represent. This petition to save it now has over 10,000 signatures. And we heard last week about its importance locally, which is something I know firsthand. I'm sure others on the committee do too. It provides a real local connection and local knowledge about upcoming new musicians. And it means, you know, I cannot stress that and the importance of that, that someone might hear a young local music piper playing something from their own village or their own locality, and that's heard in, you know, someone in Spear Bridge will be heard in Stornoway or whatever it might be. It's immense. And it means that, you know, I cannot understate, you know, overstate that enough. What's your response to that?
Well, I mean, as Louise touched on there, at the moment we have two separate teams making piping programmes, one in English and one in Gaelic. And our proposal is that we'll have a common team, and actually the Radio and Gael programme is made from Inverness to be able to supply both Radio Scotland and Radio and Gael. And in addition to that, the podcast, which will have live performance music in it as well, which they can then be played out to, as Boyack's point, be played out within the piping programmes. So they will remain rooted in the communities, and piping will remain a very prominent feature of our linear schedules, our live radio schedules, as well as what we're pushing into now on demand services.
More broadly, last week, I think it was clear that there is a kind of educational and development aspect to all of these shows in terms of nurturing young musicians. And we've touched on this a bit already. But I think it's true to say that there are many well-established musicians who credit their career development to these three standalone shows. And that's been integral to their success. And without that, I think last week it was clear that the future of young musicians in Scotland will be bleak if these shows are lost. What reassurance can you give us that that won't happen?
Taking piping, we will still be celebrating young musical talent. Young Trad's absolutely fantastic, doing a brilliant job. But also, we will still have piping on Radio Scotland. We will still be a piping show on Radio Nangale. And we will be making a podcast round about the world and other moments. So we will still have moments to celebrate talent. They will still exist. And then also, and we genuinely feel excited about the new competitions that we're launching. And within that, that's a huge moment for young musical talent in Scotland. That's a moment where they'll be broadcast on Radio Scotland. We'll be looking at how we feature them across BBC Scotland's platforms more widely. They will be working in partnership with some of the fantastic organisations within Scotland. That should become a real moment all throughout the year, where we have these competitions, where we can form relationships with young talent, and also build an awareness of that as an opportunity for young talent as well.
Okay. Thank you, Camina.
Thank you. Ms. Minto, do you want to come back in?
Thank you. It was just I was thinking of reflecting on the answers that you've just given there as well. With the other competitions, there are clear pathways to continue broadcasting. I'm concerned that there's not the same in the jazz. If you could comment on that. There's traditional music, you've got travelling folk, you've got other programmes, Gary Innes, all these programmes that you could come on. What's the pathway for a young up-and-coming jazz musician on Radio Scotland?
I think just to reiterate, Key Sessions is our live strand, and that will be an opportunity for musicians to perform and play. Also throughout our schedule, it's not just these particular programmes that celebrate our musical talent. We've got fantastic documentaries and performance pieces on Radio Scotland TV where musicians come together. We had a fantastic moment for COP26 called Changing Landscapes, where we had a special composition and musicians performed the soundtrack. So there's a raft of opportunities throughout our schedules and our platforms where musicians will come through, but Key Sessions will be an opportunity.
And that's just within our own services. So, we are obviously very focused on our services and on Scottish audiences, but we can also play a part to help talent progress through other BBC services, including in that specific genre too. What we can do is we can be here in Scotland to identify that talent, to work with partners like the Conservatoire and offer them not just their first start, but as you say, that second, that second phase, and then potentially on beyond that.
I think, as Mr. Cameron said very eloquently, the connection that young musicians have with Radio Scotland came across palpable last week, and I am concerned that I keep hearing the word moment, whereas previously it was an hour every week, and there just feels like, as I think Sarah used the word, a disconnect between what Radio Scotland as our national radio station is broadcasting compared to what a huge volume of people that have signed petitions are looking for. So I'll stop there.
Look, I think that's exhaustive questions. If I could ask a final question, and I guess, how to phrase this one? You used the phrase value for all earlier on, and you're talking about some of the financial constraints and some of the competition for audience numbers in terms of commercial radio, all these kind of other areas to do this. But if I look to traditional music, folk music, which is the genre that I follow most from the ones that are here, it seems that launch of things like Transatlantic Session, that and some of the other work that the BBC has done in those areas has built up to what is an incredibly strong offering in Scotland now in terms of Celtic connections, the festivals and everything. And I guess the worry is that without that kind of, as a public sector broadcaster, you can have a role that maybe some commercial stations can't have in nurturing that talent and things. So with the launch of the new competitions, do you see jazz growing in that way and the classical, a reinforcement of the classical position as well? As if I understood correctly, it's a Scottish classical competition that you're running as opposed to the BBC standing one that's a national one at the moment. So just a bit of reflection, because I think we all love the culture from Scotland, but there is concern out there that, you know, this could be diminished. So what would you see as a successful outcome of the strategy you're planning?
You make a really good point about how we build into bigger things. So first of all, I think we have to be really clear with the financial constraints and the changing audience about where we really add value in Scotland. And traditional music is a fantastic example. And, you know, we should absolutely continue to invest and build. And that's something uniquely Scottish that we can absolutely add. I think also in the world of new talent and how the BBC has a relationship with new talent, again, that's something we will continue to invest in and own. But part of our job in the commissioning team and wider BBC Scotland is to connect through the industry, but also, you know, with our BBC network colleagues as well. So to your point about, you know, their competitions, we're have active conversations about who's coming through our pipeline and who our network colleagues should be aware of as well. So I think that's something we would be looking to do with these competitions. Appreciate we're launching them in the financial year, so there's some work to be done, but I would imagine that building over the years, and it certainly would be an ambition.
Thank you. Mr. Carson, do you want a final word?
I think just a final thought is exactly as you say, our role as a public service broadcaster in finding, identifying, nurturing, promoting Scottish talent is actually something we're doubling down on in this strategy. I mean, not without change, we accept that, but that really is at the heart of it.
Okay, I think that concludes our session this morning. Thank you very much for your attendance, and I now move into private session.